Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Fino Payments Bank Limited Q2 FY22 investor conference call hosted by Axis Capital Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone telephone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Praveen Agarwal from Axis Capital Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Melissa. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this earnings call of Fino Payments Bank. First of all, I would like to congratulate Rishi and his team for being the first payments bank to get listed on the stock exchanges. It's really a heartening moment, and the results have been quite remarkable. Would request Rishi to share his key highlights on the results, post which we'll open the floor for Q&A. Just from the management team, we have Mr. Rishi Gupta, MD and CEO, Mr. Ketan Merchant, CFO, and Sayantan Mitra from the investor relations team. Yeah, over to you, Rishi.
All investors and analysts, thank you very much for taking time out for Fino Payments Bank first earnings conference call for quarter two FY22. It gives me great pleasure to take you through yet another profitable quarter and a half for Fino Payments Bank. In fact, with quarter two FY22 in greens, we concluded our seventh consecutive quarter in profit. Further, every quarter has been better than the previous for us, barring the two COVID impacted quarters. Our quarter two FY22 performance is better than quarter four FY21 performance across all parameters, starting from throughput to transaction volumes and to revenues to profit. In fact, Fino is one of the unique fintech which is in this space where growth and profitability is both coming into this. The model by itself provides for it. With growth, the profitability comes along with it. We are in a unique position and differentiated from the other fintechs, where we are able to achieve both growth and profitability together. India is witnessing a revolution as more and more payments-focused fintechs are gaining momentum and prominence. Globally, we have seen how fintech behemoths have become investor favorites. The risk-free model of fintechs coupled with asset and scalable structure is what provides comfort to investors. To top it, companies which demonstrate high growth command premium multiples as well. Fino Payments Bank is no different. It is a fintech built in India, built for India, rather for Bharat. By its unique nature of regulation, payments banks are not allowed to lend, and this makes the regulation itself similar to the model that fintech engines on. When it comes to growth, Fino Payments Bank has demonstrated exponential growth over the last few years of its existence. Our CFO will take you through in detail through this piece in a while. Fino Payments Bank is a transaction-focused fintech which aims to cater to payments and banking requirements of emerging India. Typically positioned at the middle of the pyramid comprising around 600-700 or 60-70 crores Indians. The payment medium used by segments of customers is very different from the ones that are preferred at the top of the pyramid by affluent Indians. The way it works is, we set up a merchant in a small town, in a village across the country, some 800,000+ which we have set up. This merchant, we convert that into a banking agent point. This is your typical neighborhood mom-and-pop shop. The merchant, in that, after conversion into a banking agent, does banking transactions for customers who come to his shop to buy some groceries or anything else. By virtue of his presence in the village, because of his presence in which he's already known to the customers, there is already a relationship which a merchant has with the customer. The customer has trust to deal and engage with the merchant and give their money or do transactions. The merchant is able to bring millions of customers and crores of customers who are there across the country into banking. The merchant earns commissions in the process. His livelihood becomes better. He sees a better footfall in his village, plus his status in his community goes up because he becomes a banking agent or a banker. The customer in the process is able to get a lot of convenience, neighborhood banking 24/7 nearly, because the merchant opens up at 6, 7 A.M. in the morning, is there till about 10 10 p.m. in the night. So by virtue of his presence, he is able to service customers at very early hours or late in the evening when normally a bank branch would typically be closed. So during, because of this model which we have built up, as I mentioned earlier, growth and profitability comes together. To address this needs, Fino offers multiple products through the merchant network, which are specifically designed for this segment of target customers. Some of the flagship products of Fino Payments Bank include remittances, which is your urban to rural remittances for migrants who come from villages to work in your urban areas. Micro ATMs, these are small machines which are given to merchants to withdraw money from his own galla, which he uses for cash. And the micro ATM actually connects through the debit card into the NPCI platform and a transaction is enabled. Aadhaar enabled payment system is another cash withdrawal product where he can withdraw cash through biometrics. Current account, savings account, cash management services. These are products which are offered to your NDFCs, MFIs, logistics companies, online companies, taxi hailing companies, wherever anybody wants to deposit cash in across the country. Bill payments and host of other cross-sell products which are there. We are also in the process of bringing some new products largely around investments, which is your mutual funds and also international remittances. We recently have started to offer credit through some partnerships we have built up on NBFCs, where the risk of the credit is on the books of the NBFC rather than on the bank. So from our presence and deep presence in the payments as well as in the liabilities business, we are actively now getting engaged more on the credit as well as on the investment side. So our endeavor is to be a platform for customers for rural India or for Bharat, where they can come and get all kinds of financial services across the gamut of products, whether on credit, whether on liabilities, payments, or investments. The revenue model in each of the products for us is different. While we charge the customer in products like remittances and CASA, our B2B partners pay for the fees for CMS, and issuing banks actually pays for the interface for micro ATM and APS. So the burden on customers is not much as far as charges are concerned. The take rates and gross margins also vary product to product. All of these products generate an organic footfall of to our 8 lakh plus merchants, enabling banking points spread across 90% of the districts. As a result, we have a nil customer acquisition cost. This merchant point also acts as a funnel to enable more and more customers into the formal financial services ecosystem. All these customers become familiar to the ecosystem over a period of time. The merchant attempts to upsell a savings account of Fino to them. This is where the customer journey in the digital financial ecosystem commences. Gradually, the customer starts using digital platforms on their own and transacts on their own. This is where we witness transformation of our customers from an aspirational customer to an affluent customer. With more balances in his savings account, he has more disposable income with him to buy various saving as well as wealth products, which we cross-sell through our ecosystem. With even more transformation, he may require loan products as well. And we have seen a good traction, at least on the pilot, which we are doing on the customer credit point. This opens up a tremendous funnel of opportunity to do more with the same customer. The obvious question which would come in everybody's mind is, why would a customer remain with Fino post his or her transform journey? We have seen this ecosystem prefers, or this customer prefers ecosystem which are reliable, trustworthy, and are ready to help them out for any grievance at any point of time. We have largely seen in digital ecosystems alone, there is a very weak grievance handling system. So because of which many customers, and especially our target customers, may not feel comfortable. So the physical ecosystem where physical and digital are married, the customer can actually note down their grievances through our physical ecosystem. So this acts as an added advantage to the customer. With our merchant points ubiquitous till the last mile, they act as the trust points as well as for these customers. And even in the digital world, not everything will be fully digital. The perfect world will have more digital as such. These are also answers the massive growth we have seen on our UPI platform over the last few quarters. Just to share some numbers with you, which are anyway there in the presentation. From 1164 throughput in H1 FY21 of UPI to 5854 throughput in H1 in FY22. our UPI throughput has grown by more than four times in the last on a year-on-year basis in H1. On the overall payment ecosystem in India, we have a segment which transacts in cash and other segments transacts digitally. If you take your attention to slide number 24 of our investor presentation, you will see that both these ecosystems are growing at a phenomenal pace. The cash in circulation right now in India is at all-time high, nearly 29.5 lakh crore. And when you look at the cash in circulation from payments perspective, you need to also look at the velocity of the cash in circulation as well, because the money which is there in circulation multiplies many times during the year. At the same time, digital spends have also grown exponentially. Hence, both these ecosystems offer tremendous growth potential. And Fino is uniquely positioned to gain from both best of both the worlds. Because of our physical presence, we can gain physically as well as digitally. With multiple cash digitization products as well as dedicated mobile UPI application, customers of Fino have an omni-channel option to transact. Why do customers repeatedly come to Fino, or why would they repeatedly transact with us? I think our convenience of the neighborhood banking, which I mentioned in the beginning of my speech, they know that merchant personally, which acts as an added advantage. The trust on the brand, it's an RBI licensed bank which facilitates the services. In tier 3 cities and towns of India, one needs to travel to the nearest point and spend money on the same to avail basic banking services. When such services are available at the doorstep of the customer with flexible timings, it becomes a natural choice for them to transact through that medium. Just imagine if you are living in a society in anywhere in the country, you go down and you are able to transact for banking services in your neighborhood, just down. It's very different experience than going to a branch, which could be a few kilometers or a few miles away. So that is the kind of revolution which we have been able to build. And that is something I would like you to visualize, that going to a merchant shop and doing banking transactions along the while you also buy your bread and butter. A rapid addition of net current accounts and savings accounts is a testimony to this, that more and more customers are now coming to our platform. We opened nearly 8.33 lakh new current and savings accounts in H1 FY22 compared to 11.3 lakh in the full year of FY21. To take you through more such numbers in detail, I will now hand over the call to our CFO, Ketan Merchant.
Thank you, Rishi, and thank you, Praveen, for the introduction. Very quickly, a warm welcome to everyone who's on the call. Rishi already mentioned about our business model, our trajectory, which is going, and Praveen mentioned about our result as well. I'll just start off with what I think Fino is. For me, or for all of us at Fino Payments Bank is a fast-growing, profitable fintech, a very unique proposition. Fast-growing, and I'll dovetail into the numbers, and a profitable as well. Why is Fino a unique story? Let me try and answer this, you know, through our revenue trajectory. In FY17, which was our first year of operations as a payment bank, we earned a revenue of rupees 171 crores. This kept on growing every year, and by FY21, our revenue was 4.5x of FY17 at 791 crores. This translates into a CAGR growth of 45%. But it's not about numbers. I'll just take everyone through the evolution of Fino products. If you go to slide 9 of our investor deck, it captures in FY17, BC banking and remittance were our mainstream of businesses whilst we were doing else. By the time we came to FY19, the innovation at its core, and Rishi earlier alluded towards the micro ATM and AEPS, that had taken momentum and, you know, were around 20% of our revenue. When we come to FY21, the growth of the normal BAU products were there, and we also evolved into new products, subscription-based CASA and CMS, which were 11%. As we speak in H1, 11.4% of CASA and CMS, you know, that was the percentage of revenue, it has increased to around 16.8%. So this is the kind of innovative products which we are essentially bringing out. The most heartening thing is, even in the current year, as I said, our revenue has grown by 36% YOY. All our product segments are showing very healthy growth. A larger part of growth is being driven by some of our high margin products, which I just explained about CASA and CMS. On an average, on a daily basis in H1, we opened around 6,000 new CASA accounts. That's a kind of a trajectory which we are looking at in terms of our CASA growth. In addition, it's not only about opening an account, but the spend on every transaction through a Fino debit card has increased by 6% in H1. And also, we have achieved 75% of our transactions in H1, what we did in CASA in full year 21. It was 2,156 in FY21, 2,156 crores. And in H1, we've achieved 1,623 crores. That is the growth which we are looking at. Throughput on CMS grew by a whopping 185% YOY. This is on the back of some of the new mandates which we've got on. Thus, this is what growth means to us. Our mature products, as I explained in the evolution of our journey from 17, continue to grow around 25%. And whilst our new products are growing at 80% YOY. For us, it is also about investing in growth. In this year, in H1 to FY22, we've added 120 new employees. This is, we have done it in some of our geographies where we want to expand as well. It was a conscious call to deepen our presence across geographies in East and South, which are our growing geographies, like West Bengal, Orissa, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Assam, Chhattisgarh, is where we've added. In addition, we're also, you know, putting resources for digital place as well. We are growing our in-house technology digital team as well. Despite all of this investment which we've done, our profit has grown by 73%. Also, despite the additions which we have done in our revenue count or in our employee count, we have improved our revenue per employee from 29.5 lakhs in FY21 to 32 lakhs in for quarter 2 FY22. This is an annualized number. Overall, in quarter 2 FY22, our transaction income has grown by 32% in old channel and equal 35% in open banking channel as well. Our gross margin for our own channel essentially is around 45%. On the take rates, we have a take rate of 0.6 in quarter 2 FY22, which is largely range bound. Overall, in terms of margin, our margin is in the range of 34%, 34% in quarter 2 FY22. That again has stayed largely range bound with an upward bias. All of this combined has helped us to improve our profit margin despite the investment in the people which we've done and marketing expenses which we've done incrementally for the Fino 2.0. Our PAT margins have improved from 2.6% in FY21 to 3.3% in quarter 2 FY22. For us, it is all about focusing on growth. And as I explained, we are attempting to grow in the digital space. We are attempting to enhance and deepen our presence as resonated by the explanation on the employee count. In addition, ROE, return on equity, is the important matrix where we judge ourselves with. In quarter 2 FY22, our ROE was excess of 20%, and that's the benchmark which we are essentially looking at. You know, it's a fintech with a difference. Having said that, with the new primary issuance which we have seen, we will, you know, for this particular year, there will be a dent in ROE because of the primary issuance which has come now. But in long term, we are looking at a sustainable ROE of what current benchmark which we have already achieved. Growth. Just to give some numbers, in the past 5 years, we've grown by 45% CAGR on the top line, as I explained. Currently, our growth is in the range of 35 to 36%, and that is the kind of growth which we are essentially, you know, aiming for. As per the CRISIL report, our industry is expected to grow by 25% with the kind of ecosystem which we have created of. We would want to continue our current trajectory of growth in the times to come. on a very simplistic basis, on an exit run rate of September 2021, if we annualize the revenue, it crosses over 1,000 crore plus. And the PAT margin on that should be around 4%. So that is it from my side. Praveen, I'll hand it over back to you and happy to take questions between myself and Rishi.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may enter star and one on their touchtone telephone. If your questions have been answered and you wish to withdraw yourself from the queue, you may enter star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, you may enter star and one. Participants, if you have a question, you may enter star and one. We have the first question from the line of Sharon Samuel, an investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, Mr. Samuel, please.
Yes. Congratulations to the Fino team for the excellent results, better than really expected. And the listing could have been better, but the market takes some time to recognize new business models. No worries on that. My question is to understand if Fino has any plans to establish its own insurance and AMC company. That is one. Second, is there any merger plan with Paytech amalgamation or merger? Whatever that is in mind. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Samuel. And thank you for your kind words. On the insurance and the AMC, as we part of our strategy, which is called DTP, where we focus on distribution, technology, and our ecosystem is more on partnership. We believe in leveraging each other's resources and strengths. I personally believe insurance and AMCs, there are a lot of good companies and platforms which are available in the country. So we want to continue to be distributors and sellers of insurance and AMCs rather than manufacturers of some of the products. While we have customer insights because of our deep engagement with the customer, those insights are actually shared with the insurance and the AMC platforms. And on basis of that, some of the products we are able to specifically manufacture for us, and we are able to sell it through that process. So for us, we would continue to work with other AMCs and insurance companies rather than setting our own. Coming to your second question on Fino consolidation or the merger of Fino Paytech with Fino Bank, that is something which will trigger in June of 2022 when we complete our 5 years of operations. So at that point, and this we have already stated, we will be looking at the merger of bringing Fino Paytech at the bank level, and it will be a kind of a reverse merger subject to the approvals from the regulators and other NCLT and other regulatory bodies. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, to ask a question, you may enter star and one. We have the next question from the line of Ravi Singh from Motilal Oswal Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Congratulations for the listing and good second quarter. So my first question is on breakup of the OPEX. So we have 1Q data from the RHP in terms of the merchant payouts. From the OPEX, what was the breakup from the merchant payout in 2Q this year and 2Q last year?
So Ravi, if I understand your question right, you're looking at the variable cost which we have in terms
yes.
of the merchant and distribution payout which we do, right, which constitutes broadly around 70-72%. Are you alluding towards the changes which happen between a quarter to quarter? Because that will be a function of the product which has evolved off.
So overall number is fine. In 1Q from RHP, I have total OPEX of 200 crores, from which 145 was merchant payout. This quarter, total OPEX was 230.8 crores. How much of that was merchant payout in 2Q?
So on the total OPEX, which is the merchant payout, essentially for this particular quarter is 161 crores or 160.8 crores is the merchant payout which is there for this particular quarter.
Okay, fine. Do you have number handy for the last year second quarter?
Last year second quarter was around 112 crores is what was the distribution or the product cost or the distribution payout which we had.
Okay, okay. And second question, generally in the trends on the throughput in the micro ATM and AETS, on the slide number 44, where you have given quarterly trend. So 1Q was impacted by the second wave. So can you throw some light in terms of the movement from 1Q22 to 2Q22? What draws the reduction while there is momentum in other businesses? Micro ATM and AETS throughput, what was the reason of decline?
So, Ravi, in terms of the throughput of micro ATM and AEPS, you know, in quarter two, it is 13,068. We serve is 14,655. I think out here, it is also a function of what is happening essentially in the market outside. It is also a function of, you know, the balance which we are doing between our take rates and our margin and what the rest of the industry is doing of. Just to give a perspective, is it a seasonal kind of a thing or is it a permanent kind of a reduction which has happened out here? Our understanding essentially is no, because the momentum and the trajectory which is there is going good. As we speak until, you know, the October trajectory was, you know, higher than what we are seeing out here. So it is driven by two things. One is market. The other one is the balance of take rate and the margin which we are doing through, and from a long term perspective or from a quarter three perspective, it seems to be, you know, recovering quite well.
Understood. Thank you. I'll get back into it.
Thank you. Participants, if you have a question, you may enter star and one. To ask a question, you may enter star and one. We have the next question from the line of Sri Karthik from Investec. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. Is there a 80-20 rule that applies to your merchant also, in the sense that would, let's say, the top 20 percent of your merchants contribute disproportionately to your volume? Any concentration numbers would be useful.
Yeah, Shri Karthik, hi. Your assessment is right. It is a retail-driven, you know, model wherein 80-20 definitely applies to us as well. And coincidentally, it is exactly in the range of 80-20. However, for us, it is also the endeavor that, you know, we have a separate team, which we call a business enabling team, which is trying to reduce that gap up. But currently, as we speak, largely that 80-20 rule for our merchant is essentially applying.
Thank you. The second question is, while you try to explain to us as to how a digital business model can coexist in a digital world, more particularly in the case of domestic remittances, isn't UPI, as UPI gets more widely accepted into the hinterland, would that not pose an immediate threat to the domestic remittances business?
So domestic remittances business has two legs, which is there. One is the leg of cash digitization, which is the person in the urban, they earn money in cash and they go to a merchant point and deposit the cash with the merchant, because he doesn't have money in the bank, because the company or where he's working doesn't transfer money or salary into the bank account, or he's a local hawker or somebody who earns money in cash, so he only has cash. So the first leg of domestic remittance is that he goes to a merchant point in, say, Delhi, Bombay, and deposits money with the merchant. The second leg is when somebody in his village, his wife or his son or daughter, goes to a merchant point again and withdraws the money through a debit card or a Aadhaar-enabled payment system. So we have, right now, we have not seen any impact of UPI coming on this, both the legs of the businesses, whether it is at the deposit side or at the beneficiary, because UPI is more of a smartphone digitized cash model where the money is the bank account and smartphone. And as I mentioned in my opening remarks also, there are a lot of apprehensions that people are having, because of lack of grievance handling, and if the money gets stuck or any other thing, people might not move into that process. Having said that, on the rural side, as I mentioned, we have seen a 4x growth in our UPI business for people who have already moved on to our CASA account. So when we open up a CASA account, we this is a subscription account which is there. A customer pays a small sum of money. On account of that, he gets a platform for 1 year, including the debit card. And in that process, he can pay for debit cards, he can use the debit cards, he can do UPI transactions. So right now, we have seen that digitization of cash as well as withdrawal of cash is largely cash in this far as the remittance is concerned. In future, UPI will definitely see, and we are also pushing that agenda for our customers, because our model is more on the subscription savings account. So we want people to open more and more accounts with us, and through that platform, we get a fixed fee, and that fee then can take care of UPI transactions and can help us to cross-sell our customers. So we don't see UPI as a threat to our business, especially on the remittance side, but more of an enablement for us to do more with the customer digitally as well as in cross-sell.
Thank you. And then if I may, just one more. From a competitor slash peer benchmarking perspective, what we notice is, for example, there's one more other listed entity called DigiSpice, which is also claiming to have like 8 lakh merchants. Then there's players like Neogen and then Pay Nearby, each having like at least 15-20% market share in the micro ATM, Aadhaar enabled payment systems, etc. So whom do you internally benchmark with when you're comparing yourself on various product categories?
So when we look at ourselves, we look at ourselves as a bank. So we have ability to manufacture as well as cross-sell other party products. And compared to the names which you just mentioned, they are just distributors. They are API partners for a bank. We also have somewhere around 45-50 API partners who are a part of our open banking platform. So they use our platform for remittances as well as micro ATM and APS. We ourselves benchmark on some of our products with banks like RBL, IDFC, Yes Bank, IndusInd Bank, who are the owners and of products. So like we offer CASA products, which is not being offered by others because they are not manufacturers of those products. So that is where our benchmarking is different. You can also say that our nearest competition could be in the payments bank space is Airtel Payments Bank, which is also doing similar businesses, especially on the remittance and the CMS side. But our unique proposition on APS, micro ATM, and CASA is different because we also issue physical debit cards.
Thank you. And the last question, our tax rate has been zero. Any reason why?
So Shri Karthik, you know, we have accumulated tax loss, and which is why our effective tax rate is zero, and that's how it's going to be for the next couple of years.
And, you know, when you measure your capital adequacy ratio, what is the risk weight that you use, sir? I mean, it's a theoretical question, I know, but where is the risk weight originating from?
Yeah, Shri Karthik, it's a good question. You know, we do not have any credit risk emitting on our book. And it's not an asset, you know, based business. This is a very asset-like business, but as per the regulatory norms, the fixed assets or the technology investments which you're essentially doing, also all the fixed assets have also to be risk weighted off. So our risk weighted assets is largely, or there is zero credit risk. It will be driven by the other assets and fixed assets. That's how our CRAR is measured in terms of regulatory.
Participant, hello? Mr. Karthik, do you have any more questions?
No, I'm good, thanks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, to ask a question, you may enter star and one. We have the next question from the line of Chandrasekhar Sridhar from Fidelity International. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. Couple of questions. Just again, on this whole EPS and micro ATMs, the throughput flatlining, just what competitively you said you've taken some calls, maybe just some more information on that would be useful.
Chandra, Chandrasekhar. On the micro ATM and APS, as I said, it is business wherein in micro ATM we carry more than 50% of market share. In APS, we are the fourth largest service provider. From a growth perspective, or from Q1 to Q2, which is 14,655 to 13,068. This is function of two things. One is, if you come and see our margins out here, in quarter one the margins was 50.6%, and in quarter two it is 51.8%. This is on our own channel. On the open banking, the margins are largely flat. We also are enhancing our penetration. If you come and see the onboarding revenue, which is part of our journey in terms of micro ATM and APS, from 17.7 crores it has gone to 24 crores. Sometimes these new customers or the new merchants which you've onboarded has, takes time in terms of, coming into the transaction throughput. From an overall long-term standpoint, micro ATM and AEPS transactions become are very integral part. In the past, we have grown over 200%, of this thing. We were the pioneers of this product, and we've grown over 200% CAGR. Year from year on, as I mentioned in my earlier thing, we are looking at a BAU kind of growth, which should be anywhere around 20-25%. However, endeavor is to get more and more micro ATM on our banking platform, which will enable us to grow irrespective of how the market share. So there are two ways. One is market growing, and the other way is we getting more merchants onboarded for this. So that is our kind of strategy. As regards to margin, our we will just look at it based on how the market is behaving it off. If someone goes and does too much of undercutting, we will take a very optimistic and a cautious view. How do we want to play around? We may not, currently we do not feel the need to go completely disruptive in terms of our margin, which are very healthy, as I said, in 51.8 for our own margin. So we are waiting and watching. And as I said, quarter three beginning for this one has been for micro ATM and APS has resonated our view in terms of the growth, which can happen with maintaining a balance between volume and margin.
So my understanding is that device prices have gone down pretty significantly here. So basically it's not very difficult for somebody else to flood the market with the device. Is that something fair to assume?
Yes, Chandrasekhar, this is increasingly becoming a commoditized product as well. But however, it's not about, someone earlier also asked the question difference between the fintech players and us. One point which we have to essentially note is for completing the transaction, you require an underlying banking platform as well. So that's where we are providing. And as regards to the competition on device pricing, etc., it is also about the complete product suite which we are giving. For us, a micro ATM or APS merchant or the distribution point, they can essentially also open in CASA and augment their income more as compared to other fintech player wherein they are going by the price war. But your understanding is right. Yes, there is a sort of a device price which reduction which has happened, and that's how the market is looking at. But at the current stage, with what we are seeing over last 2-3 months, we will continue our long-term strategy to grow micro ATM and APS in a balanced way.
Sure. And there's been a change in the accounting policy, I think, which you're using. I think the margins now include the depreciation has been shifted into segmental numbers. Is that correct?
There is no change in terms of the PAT margin. What we've essentially done, last year also, we continue to depreciate all the devices which are less than 5,000 in the same year. Earlier, it was shown in the different line, which was shown in the depreciation line. From a prudence point, we have started including that over the line as well. So from a PAT margin perspective, nothing essentially changes. From a profitability perspective, nothing changes. We are not amortizing anything. Earlier also, we were expensing it out. Now also, we continue to expense it out. It's only between the classification, wherein earlier, full year, a depreciation was shown in that line, and now it is being shown in the product cost line.
Sure. Just a couple of more questions. One is just on the remittances side. There seems to be a drop in both Q1 and the API channel margins. What's driving that? And then just on the CASA side, is the total revenues which you have, I think, which you reported of close to about 27 odd crores from the breakup.
Sorry to interrupt. This is the operator. Mr. Sridhar, your audio is fluctuating, sir.
Sorry, can you hear me now? Is it clear?
Are you on the handset?
Yes, I'm on a handset.
Okay, sir, you'll have to be a little more loud, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Is it clear?
Yes, it's better. Thank you.
All right, just the CASA income was about 27.6 crores, but the subscription was 21 crores. Just the differential, is that the interest earned on the CASA or is there something else?
No, there are two kinds of things which happen. You know, whilst majority of our CASA accounts are coming from subscription based, there are some traditional CASA accounts as well. So the growth is what we are looking in subscription. In addition, you're right. We pay 2.75% on the on our saving account balances and 0% on current account balances, and we essentially deploy it in GSECs and market securities and FDs as well. So there is a margin of somewhere around in the range of around 150 basis points out there as well. So it's a combination of all of three.
Right. So you basically made 7 crores in the quarter from interest earned, and the 21 crores is basically subscription. That's broadly.
It will be combination of one more factor. As I essentially said, is that one is the subscription base. The other one is the charges which we are earning on the erstwhile old CASA, traditional CASA model which we are running, which is not a big component, but in the range of 15%. And the third one is the interest revenue which we are earning from the balances which we are deploying. So there are three components to that.
Sure. And then this one will fall on the margin in both the open as well as own channels in remittances.
So, sorry, Chandrasekhar, what is your question?
I was just saying that your gross margins, on the remittances on your own as well as API have fallen. While they're up sequentially, it's just down YOY. Just take us through what's happening in that case.
No, I think, remittance over last, 18 months, this is one of the products which is, been impacted essentially by COVID, or maybe this is the only product for us which got impacted. And as is evident from the throughput, if we can see on the slide 45 of our investor deck as well, in the lockdown, there was a reverse migration, which, essentially took, people back to their respective territories, etc. So remittance has been a recovery phase for all players, because of the reason which I just said. Coming back to the margin, remittance is highly commoditized product. Okay, so, from a quarter one FY21 to quarter two FY22, for us, it is quarter two FY22 is 20.6% of the margin which we are looking at. But for us, remittance is an entry product. Remittance essentially binds us with customers. It gives us a cross-selling opportunity. So that's how we are looking at remittance in all possible manner. Remittance will cross-sell is really an essential aspect. Also, in terms of our remittance, it's a combination of what we do on our own channel and what we do on our open banking channel as well. Wherein currently in quarter two, 80% of our remittance is coming on open banking channel, which generates, somewhere around 4% or 3.6% of margin. But the point to note is this margin essentially becomes the EBITDA or PAT margin as well, wherein we do not have to do any further marginal cost. So is there a strategic reason? Is there a movement? Is there a directional change expected into the margin of remittance? I do not think so. it will be remain competitive product, and we will also look at, you know, growing in a balanced manner, wherein without putting any additional challenges in the market, how do we grow it off, and more importantly, how do we use it as an entry point for customer entering into our funnel.
Just to add to what Ketan is saying, is that the margin which is there is a reflection on the value of remittance which is there. So if you have a 1,000 rupee remittance, it has a separate value and a separate margin. If you have a 2,000 rupees, 4,000 rupees, so margin varies depending on the value of which bucket has done more value of transaction. So there is Chandrasekhar, there is no real reason why there is a from 3.8 to 3.6. It is just could be a factor of some higher value transactions would have happened more in quarter two, which are at a lower margin compared to smaller value transactions, which are at a higher margin. So it just could be a change in the product, in the mix of the transaction value, per transaction value as such.
Understood. Very clear. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, to ask a question, you may enter star and one. We have the next question from the line of Ravi Singh from Motilal Oswal Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Yeah, just a follow-up. In micro ATM and AETS, what is the share of open banking in throughput and how has it changed?
In terms of micro ATM and AEPS, approximately 75% of our business essentially is own banking. And has it evolved over a period of time? I think, you know, the balance is essentially there. Having said that, we are making conscious attempt to grow both AEPS, micro ATM on our own channel, and as well as the open banking channel. Sorry, you have a second question as well?
No. So that was it. So just to be clear, 70-80% on own and rest on open banking. And remittance is reverse. Their API or open banking is higher.
Remittance, yes, it's a strategic call that wherein we are, you know, trying to maintain anywhere in the range of 70-80 of open banking.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Thank you. Participants, if you have a question, you may enter star and one. We have the next question from the line of Hiten Jain from Invesco. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Just to get some more clarification on micro ATM and AEPS. Is it that this quarter you have lost market share in that segment?
This quarter, yes, there has been a reduction coming out. In terms of the market share, we continue to be above 50% of the market share. It is also a function of geographies. In certain geographies, the market has overperformed us. In certain geographies, we have also overperformed market. But yes, indeed, it is a function of reduction in overall cash withdrawal in this particular industry. And in certain cases, we've also lost market share.
Okay, and what would you attribute to, because given what you were saying that the currency in circulation is quite high, so is it that there has been less usage of cash while this is just one quarter, but any reason that you can attribute to in terms of reduction in withdrawals in cash this quarter?
No, not really. Actually, we should not take this one quarter as a reflection of any change in the cash in circulation or anything else. It is largely a factor of some more aggressive pricing done by some of our competition, where Ketan mentioned earlier that we wanted to balance it between the margin and the price as such. So this is just, I would say, an aberration. We should see quarter three coming back to a higher level from this current levels. On cash on circulation, the cash on circulation has gone up and continues to be quite active. Sometimes you can say that in COVID one or COVID two, which is in quarter one FY22, we saw a higher cash withdrawal also because of the fact that there was a lot of panic which was there amongst people. So cash in both in COVID one as well in COVID two, where people draw 6,000 rupees, they withdraw 10,000 rupees, and they kept something for medical reasons and for other reasons. That is one of the reasons why you see a jump in quarter one FY22 in spite of COVID, largely because of some cash holding which people did in quarter one. And this could again be a reason that they are surplus cash, so that's why the number went down in quarter two. But from a cash in circulation point of view, with 29.5 lakh crores of cash in circulation and multiple velocities during the year, there is no structural change which we can see in cash of cash withdrawal. It continues to be good. We have seen our October-November numbers. It is much healthy.
Sure. If I can ask you to explain that point where you said that competition is increasing the pricing there. Because even many fintech companies, because they don't have the payment bank license, they need a bank behind it, which is their open banking transaction business. So what is this competition that you're talking about?
So these are largely your open banking partners who are there with other banks. So they are so there is a device and then there is a charge or a cash or a commission to the merchant. We saw some aggression with two, three players in this last quarter, where they went around giving devices for free and also started to give a much higher commission to merchants as such. We believe this is more of a momentary, maybe a 1-2 quarter phenomena as such, and hopefully things will start coming back. This is a game which we have stayed away from playing in the past, and that is why our balance on margins are good as such. So it is nothing else which is there, more of a irrational competitive behavior with one or two players, especially on the micro ATM side, because they wanted to grow their own business. Our APS numbers are better than the number. Only micro ATM has come down because of this aggression which we saw with some of our other fintech players in the market.
Yeah, Hiten, this needs to be looked at in the context of the own channel transaction margin, wherein we have, you know, maintained, we were at 50.6% in quarter one, and now we are at 51.8%. So for us, it is about balancing the two rather than, you know, aggressively, unnecessarily going on a disruptive manner, because it's a temporary kind of a thing. So that's where our strategy is, and we stuck to the strategy. And as Rishi said earlier, in with the same strategy, we are seeing a, you know, kind of a growth coming back in the half of the quarter three, which you've seen.
If you see, say, in our other products, CASA has gone up by 74%. 74% of accounts opened in FY21 have already been opened in FY22. On CMS, again, we have seen a very healthy growth on our system. Micro ATM is the only product because of unhealthy competition. We have stayed away from there. In remittances, again, you see there's a big growth coming from quarter one. It's not a very big decision to be taken if you want to recapture the micro ATM market share by getting into more aggressive competitive pricing. Right now, we have stayed away from that.
And Rishi, what makes you think that this is a temporary situation where the competition is being aggressive? What makes you think that?
So because there is a cost of losing business as such, or doing business at free. So the fintechs which we mentioned are not that heavily funded compared to some of the big fintechs which are in the B2C urban category. So they have limited pool and limited capital. So for how long will they be able to fund such kind of losses in their businesses? And after some point when they will see that there is no material benefit which is coming to them, then they will obviously move back to a more rational pricing as such. Having said that, we are also not sitting idle and not doing anything. We are also going and especially targeting some of their markets where we feel there is more aggression as such. But this is more of a temporary phenomena. At least when I look at this number, it will definitely go up in quarter three.
Hiten, on some statistics out here, and you know, we have been pioneers in this micro ATM business, you know, what we started off. And as I said earlier, from FY19 to FY21, we grew this business, you know, by 203% CAGR. So in that cycle also we have seen, this is not the first cycle which we are essentially seeing where there is a price disruption which is happening. And our team's endeavor to tackle this, you know, because of we being the pioneers and we've seen some of these cycles earlier, gives us the right confidence that we'll strike the balance in this particular micro ATM APS throughput.
Great. Just last question. While obviously there is no credit risk on the balance sheet, but in 2Q21, so the previous quarter of last year, we had some 3 crores of provisions. So what was it related to?
So this was one of the old outstanding which we had to receive on account of our B2B business, which was there, and that's why in the Q2 FY21 we had this provision coming. Our business is more skewed towards retail, as we speak, and as it has evolved over during the year, and there is nil provision for this half year or this quarter as well.
So this would be from the CMS business?
This would be essentially from our business correspondence business, wherein our banking correspondence, wherein we provide transactions and we do provide services, B2B services for a couple of other financial services players as well. So, you know, that's a model which we are, running in addition to our own retail product as well. So this was pertaining to the BC business, which we carry on.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. We have the next question from the line of Jayesh Gandhi from BNP Paribas Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir, please.
Hello. Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. First question is on remittances. So I remember having a discussion at the time of the IPO that the remittance business should come back once the reverse migration issues are behind and lockdown, etc. Are removed. So how are you seeing that change on the ground?
Yeah, good afternoon, good evening. So if you look at the number, which is slide number 45, if you look at the throughput, our quarter two throughput on remittances have come to 9,449 crores. This is very close to quarter four 21 and even higher than quarter three 21. And it is roughly 1.5 times higher than quarter two FY21. So the business, as you can see from the throughput itself, has come back substantially and nearly 100% to pre-COVID levels.
Fair enough. So but how do you see the growth there next year or the next few quarters?
So we expect the growth, this quarter two growth on remittances over quarter one is it's a nearly 25% growth in that or even more. So we don't expect that number of incremental will be there. We expect around 15% or so growth coming on this on a year to 15 to 20% growth coming on this platform on a year to year basis. This is an established product for about four or five years now. And we should be more around 9,000 to 10,000 crores of throughput on a quarterly basis on a going run rate.
Okay, and do you see, so you're saying 15-20% growth next year is what you're saying?
Year on year basis.
Okay. So that was first. So that business should come back. Second question was on the balance sheet side. So obviously the IPO happened, I think. The balance sheet numbers are still muted. Can you give me some updated numbers on the net worth, etc.?
Jayesh, this is not a balance sheet business as I'd explained earlier as well. Our net worth, excluding primary issuance of 300 crores, was in the range of 160 crores. With the 300 crore issuance, we're looking at a net worth of somewhere around 460 crores.
460 crores. No, fair enough. So I guess where I was coming from is that you mentioned in your opening remarks that you have 20% ROE and your target is to achieve 20% ROE going forward. How quickly can we achieve the target?
Yes, 20% is our September quarter ROE. I also mentioned it off that with the primary issuance happening for this year for FY22, the ROE, the whilst the growth momentum is expected to continue, ROE we are looking at a 20% plus ROE from a 22-23 and then that onwards that way. So it was from an overall deployment perspective or the effective utilization of cash, we have planned in terms of next 12 to 18 months.
No, fair enough. But how do you get to 20% ROE? How quickly? Is it a 2-year target, a 3-year target?
Yeah, we are looking at coming in over a 2-year period.
Wonderful. Good to hear that. Thanks. And all the very best.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have the next question from the line of Sharon Samuels, an investor. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thanks to be again back here. Two questions. First one is there impact of government schemes on agriculture front with, a lot of money is flowing through the agriculture economy at this point? What has been the impact of?
On the first question, yes, definitely the government money as well as the other agriculture growth in rural definitely helps the rural economy and consumption in the rural space. Especially during the COVID, we saw COVID one when government gave out 30,000 crores last year in the first quarter. That definitely helped the rural economy and helped the government. Right now, the government is not giving any subsidy or anything else except for the food subsidy, which they are giving through FCI and through PDS platform, which does not impact our business directly, I can say. But just some money which get people free from PDS would definitely come for consumption in other businesses.
Sure, thanks. What about brand promotion activities, which Fino is taking? As I understand, Fino has 8.1 lakh as per your presentation. I'm sure it's more of 8.5 lakh branches at this point in time. You should be the largest open branch or bank branches in India. Even postal will be around 80,000 or SBI is half of that. There should be a little more brand promotion which Fino should be doing. Should a lot of data on the middle of the pyramid people. What is the plan for that?
You are absolutely right. Part of our fundraise is also for building up more on the brand and marketing. Recently, so we are doing a couple of things. One is recently we tied up with Pankaj Tripathi as our brand ambassador. So a lot of engagements around him on TVCs and other pamphlets and other things are there. Many times we don't see them because our target audience is different and people don't really experience Fino firsthand because this is largely meant for the mass market and the middle segment, so to say. So we like advertise in channels where our mass market segments are viewing. So you would not probably see them. Second, if you go around some of the BPCL outlets across the country and highways and rural and semi-urban, you will see Fino branding in many of those outlets. Thirdly, we are also doing board and promotions at the merchant level, which we keep on doing a few thousands every month. We keep on adding to the merchant ecosystem. And fourth is that we do quite active on the social media digital channels, but they are also largely targeting our customer segment per se. So that is one challenge which we have. A lot of people who are there on the call would not have experienced Fino either on the marketing brand promotion side or on transaction platform, because our target segments are a little different from this target segment.
Sure, thanks. My question was more towards investing community than to the rural economy. Okay, Tripathi was an excellent choice. Must say that.
Thank you.
Thank you. As there are no further questions, I would like to hand the conference back to the management for closing comments. Please go ahead, sir.
So, thank you all for participating in the first earnings call of Fino. It's been a phenomenal year. We thank our investors who have put who have put their faith and trust in Fino. We continue to perform, and our last 7 quarters is a testimony to the fact that despite the COVID restrictions or the issues which we had with COVID, our company continue to perform well. We will continue to perform, and on quarter two, you have seen a good growth over quarter one. Our endeavor is that this will continue in the foreseeable future, which is there. And I wish you, everybody on this call, a very nice evening, and look forward to more engagements in the future.
Thank you, members of the management and Mr. Agarwal. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Axis Capital, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.